Welcome back to Open Line. We are talking about the death penalty in Tennessee. We have with us Kelly Henry. She is the federal public defender, represents many of the people who are on death row and who have been executed. And fascinating discussion. We're going to take calls now. Let's go to Taylor. Hello, Taylor.
Yes?
Go right ahead. What's on your mind?
Oh, okay, Ben. Appreciate you and your guest tonight. And this is rather confusing to me on the way it operates. I appreciate what she just explained about how her team has come to be. But my thoughts are this. State of Tennessee has laws that provide for the death penalty. The federal government has laws that provide for the death penalty. And in these discussions tonight, it sounds as if, though, these attorney generals that bring a death penalty case are some kind of outlaws that are out to put someone, some innocent person to death and provide a sloppy trial. And I just don't see the franchise of this, what sounds more like an ACLU program than a federal taxpayer dollar program, coming into the state and providing a service like this that's in total opposition to the laws that have taken place. And the fact that there's five this year may seem like more than other years, but we've had plenty of years with none. We've gone for 10 years sometimes without any executions. The big shame is if we're going to have the death penalty, it doesn't take 30 years to for it to take place, and if the federal judge and the federal judiciary is going to be totally against the death penalty, why don't they sponsor laws and get it changed? I just think this program is a betrayal to the laws of the state and the federal government. Thanks a lot.
So when you say, all right, there's a lot there. When he says the program, I think what he means is when you said that you're
right.
funded with taxpayer money.
Right.
All right, I guess address what you can, and I'll ask some questions.
Sure.
But what do you think about what he's saying?
Well, I really appreciate the call and the opportunity to address what the caller had to say, because obviously I didn't do a very good job of explaining a little bit about what it is that we do. And I think it's a common misconception that we are trying to, those of us who are defending our clients are doing something to overturn a law. And you know, it's a fair question, fair comment. The reality is that the laws are what we're defending. I became a lawyer because I believe in the Constitution and I believe in upholding the Sixth Amendment and the Eighth Amendment and the 14th Amendment. And when we are investigating our clients' cases, what we're looking for is circumstances where those amendments were violated. And so we are the ones that go into court and say, this is where due process was violated. This is where, you know, the Sixth Amendment right to effective assistance of counsel was violated, or this is where, you know, race played a role in this conviction where it shouldn't. And so we very much see ourselves as defenders of the Constitution as well as defenders of our clients, because without us, then you are putting to death people who have been unjustly convicted and unjustly accused. So, I mean, I think it's a fair question, and I really appreciate the opportunity to address it.
The law says before someone is put to death, they have a right to a lawyer who can fight whatever legal battles remain, and that's where you come in.
Right.
You come in, again, at the third stage, toward the end, and you fight those battles. People say the death penalty is more expensive. That's one of the arguments against it, that it's more expensive than if we just put people in prison for life. That is because of all the lawyers that are required. It would be wrong to execute people without giving them a chance at lawyers, but I guess that's part of it, right? I mean, this is an expensive, long process because there's a lot of legal battles that go on, and that's all part of the execution process, I guess, the law as we have it now, right?
Right. I mean, when you are going to execute somebody, the Supreme Court has said over and over and over again, conservative and liberal justices have said death is different because of its finality. So if you, if the government is going to take the life of a citizen, they better be darn sure that they got the right person and that this person deserves it. You know, what I would say my experience has shown is that the law just can't do that. But because of that principle, which is, I think, something that we can all agree on, you have to have a judicial system that works. And to have a judicial system that works, you have to have defense lawyers, you have to have prosecutors, you have to have judges. And all of them, you know, set to work on these cases. And there's, every study has shown that the death penalty is more expensive, not just because of defense lawyers, we're a drop in the bucket. But you know, you look at the amount of money that they spend on these drugs, which is astronomical. The studies also show that it doesn't reduce violence. The death penalty does not work as a deterrent, and in fact, the states that don't have the death penalty have lower homicide rates than the states that do. So again, it's just, it's a failed government program.
And his other comment that I bet we'll hear some more of, the big problem is it took so long to do this,
right.
and that Tennessee went so many years without an execution,
right.
And that's why now we have this backlog.
Right.
And so I guess talk about the concern there. You know, what about the fact that it's taking so long?
Yeah.
I mean, I guess, again, the other side of that is, well, we should just execute people faster.
Right. So the reason that it takes so long is because, as I was saying, once these cases get into federal court, every procedural barrier possible is put in our way by our opponents. And so if we could eliminate procedural default, these procedural technicalities that I have spent my life litigating against, and just get to the substance of our clients' claims, we would move these cases a whole lot faster. And that's certainly something that, you know, my team and others would support. But those procedural technicalities keep the truth from coming to light until a case gets to the end. And I guess my answer to people who say this takes too long is it too long when we find out, as we did with Sedley Alley and as we did with Philip Workman, that they were innocent? You know, and it was procedural technicalities that kept those men from being able to demonstrate their innocence in court. That's the part that frustrates me. So, you know, I got pulled into those cases late in the litigation. In Philip's case, it was a situation where, you know, the medical examiner's office didn't comply with the subpoena, and so they hid the evidence until it was too late for us to do anything about it. But again, if you're going to execute somebody, let's be sure. With Sedley, we didn't get to test the DNA, and that would have provided us answers. I know Sedley's daughter is still trying to test that DNA.
Sedley Alley, what is that case, just briefly?
So Sedley Alley was a case out of Millington, Tennessee, so West Tennessee, which, as I think everybody knows, over a half of the row is from West Tennessee. Again, Shelby County represents the bulk of our cases. But Sedley was convicted of and sentenced to death for a horrific crime, the murder of Lance Corporal Suzanne Collins. 18 years old, beautiful young woman, her whole life ahead of her. Just a sad case. And as happens with many death penalty cases, once the death penalty becomes part of it, politics takes over for justice. And the momentum to convict Sedley was strong, and he was mentally ill and didn't remember where he was on the night of the crime, so he couldn't defend himself. When his case got to the very end and there was an execution date set, a new team came in, we performed a new investigation, and we realized that he had falsely confessed, which is what we find many times in DNA exonerations, and that there was evidence available of an alternative suspect who very likely could have done it, and there was DNA that could be tested. We had modest ask. We said, let's test the DNA. We presented our case, Barry Scheck from the Innocence Project and I presented our case to the Clemency Board that was made up of a lot of conservative folks who said, yeah, you should get to test the DNA. And still we weren't able to. And that's one of those cases that until DNA tells me otherwise, I will go to my grave believing Sedley Alley was innocent.
So he was executed and the DNA was not tested. Yeah. Has the DNA been tested since he was executed?
No, his daughter is suing right now because there's a new suspect that has come up, a gentleman in St. Louis named Thomas Bruce, who is suspected to be a serial killer. And he posted on his LinkedIn page that he was in Millington at the naval base, the same naval base where Lance Corporal Susan Collins was, at the same time. What's the coincidence there? So she has gone back to court and is in the process of trying to convince the courts that she should be able to test the DNA to get some answers for herself and her brother.
All right, let's go back to the phones here. Let's go to Tony. Hello, Tony.
Yes.
Go right ahead.
Yeah, I was wondering, she just brought up about Philip Borkman a while ago.
Right.
And I was just wondering, you know, she said she got in on the end of it. And I was remembering that case really because everybody said I looked so much like him. But the whole idea, though, wasn't the bullet that killed the policeman in Memphis, wasn't it lost, supposedly lost? It wouldn't, if my memory serves right, the bullet was misplaced and lost that killed the policeman. So therefore, it seems like that could have been a cover-up by the policeman. And, you know, by the policeman getting killed by friendly fire, so to say. And I was just wondering her what she had to say about that. Thank you.
Okay. What about that?
So the bullet wasn't lost, but what was withheld were the x-rays of Lieutenant Ronald Oliver's body. And the ballistics evidence showed that the bullet was more consistent with the ammunition that was being shot by the law enforcement versus what was in Philip Workman's gun. And under the law in Tennessee, if Philip had not killed Lieutenant Oliver, he would not be guilty, and or he'd be guilty of first degree murder, but he would not be eligible for the death sentence. So it was a big deal. And the question that sort of hung over the case was, well, did the bullet hit bone? And if it hit bone inside the body, then we can't conclude anything about your ballistics proof. After oral argument where they said, you know, it's our burden, you didn't come forth with the x-ray, so we don't know what happened with the bullet, so you lose. After that happened, it was discovered that the x-rays existed and that the medical examiner had not complied with the subpoena. Now, this is the same medical examiner who, you might remember, ultimately was tried in federal court for having alleged to have wrapped himself in barbed wire and placed a long bomb on his chest, which he said supporters of Philip Workman had done to her. I mean, things got really crazy in Memphis in, you know, 2004 and 2005. But when he came forward and said, hey, I have the x-ray, that gave us a whole new round of litigation for Philip and definitively proved that Lieutenant Oliver was killed by friendly fire. But it was too little too late.
All right, we have to take a break. We will continue taking calls. Joe, others, we have several calls on the line. So hold on the line, take a break. We'll be back right after this.